been on many different congregational teams over the years. Our worship service today is led by Andy Cowgill and John Sherfey of the Eastern Service Workers Association. Andy Cowgill, is that correct?
That's fine.
Grew up in Minnesota. After gaining a variety of experiences in community service, political organizing, and activism in Ecuador and San Jose, California, Boston, and elsewhere, he became a full-time volunteer organizer in 1999. For the last 13 years, Andy has been the operations manager at Eastern Service Workers Association, or ESWA, in Pleasantville. Can you hear me okay in the back? John Sherfey grew up in Williamstown in a family with deep roots in the South Jersey agricultural industry. John graduated from Stockton University in 2020. I didn't realize you were such a baby. with a bachelor's of science degree in chemistry. John began organizing full-time in 2021 after working as a chemist and running a small business. He now serves as ESWA's administrative assistant and educational coordinator. Video of today's service will be available on our YouTube channel later today. If you care to tweet during today's service, you can use the hashtag UUCCSJS. Welcome to worship. Thanks for giving me the knowledge, Kobe. child's loving words are in your word of service. Please read them with me. More than a dwelling,
living simple, beacon to the bewildered, illuminating refuge, light of love, calling to community, signal of sacred mission, shine now in the world, setting me in the place, kindle our courage, ignite intuition, spark our hearts to service, love.
Please rise now in body or spirit and sing along to our gathering hymn number 16, 'Tis a Gift to Be Simple.
Cynthia will play through the song once, and then we will sing through the song twice, and thank you to Paul for being our singer today.
With wisdom, go with wonder, go to me.
A book is provided in the foyer in which you are invited to write whatever joys and sorrows you have as you enter. I will now read what you would share. Longtime members will remember Prim Reeves, who left several years ago to live with her daughter in central New Jersey. Prim developed Alzheimer's disease and died last week. She was a very active member of the congregation for many, many years, and we loved her. The flowers this morning are given in loving memory of Arlene Yaka, who passed away in March. She would have been 95 on July 20th. We miss you. And this is from Colby. I'm personally feeling so very proud to have my friends and colleagues here today to present the most important work I've ever been involved with, helping low-income and other struggling individuals. Gina is asking for a prayer of comfort and clarity for her mom. She's back in the hospital and she's suffering. She's a beautiful light. I wish for her peace and good feelings. Let us share a quiet time together to reflect on our week. During the musical interlude, you may come forward and place a pebble in the water to acknowledge a personal joy or sorrow. Stones that make ripples in water and or a gentle sound in the chalice. Our hearts are touched by this and shared by this shared ritual, and we are connected. We hold in our hearts this morning the people who are suffering. They don't have enough food, water, shelter. We pray for the people of Ukraine and the people in our communities that do not have enough. We pray for those who are apart from us, whether by distance, time, or conflict unresolved. We pray for those who thirst, whether for water, dignity, or justice. We pray for our small, blue, fragile planet. We offer all of these and those joys and sorrows that remain unspoken in our hearts into the care of the universe. May our joys be multiplied and our sorrows diminished in this sharing. Amen. We will now take a moment to give and receive the morning offering. The ushers will come forward to pass the offertory baskets among those who are in attendance. If this is your first time visiting with us today, you may let the basket pass, as your presence is gift enough. For those who are participating online, please visit uucsjs.org and click on the yellow donate button for ways to donate. 80% of our annual budget comes from the pledges and donations of friends and members of this congregation. Each week, we see a small and sometimes great miracle happen as people open their hearts and share their resources with this community of spiritual growth. No matter how you support us, we appreciate you and your generous heart. After all, your donation is what keeps us going. And no matter how these gifts are offered, they are always most gratefully received.
Sherfey, who, as you know, is the administrative assistant and the educational coordinator, and also a full-time volunteer for the Eastern Service Workers. So I want to thank you again for hosting us. It's wonderful to see so many familiar faces, many who have volunteered, many who have donated. I want to start by expressing our sincere thanks to the entire U congregation for all that you've done, both individually and collectively, to advance the cause of service workers. We really, really do appreciate it. We talked to you at a time of skyrocketing prices for essentials, everything from food and shelter to gas and utilities. It is hitting all of us in the pocket. In our office in Pleasantville, we see it literally every day. Earlier this week, we had two successful cases of preventing utility shutoffs. We're now in the middle of a situation of multiple members who lack stable housing or have no housing at all. I want to start by describing a few of these situations anonymously that we're dealing with, because the details reveal a lot about what we're going through as a community, as a country, and where we need to go next. One of our members has worked as a school secretary for more than 20 years. Her adult son has asthma and relies on a breathing machine. She also has two young grandchildren, ages 2 and 5, at home. On Monday, she was told that she would be shut off by the electric company unless she paid $1,200 within 24 hours. She resolved to draw from her pension in order to catch up, mortgaging her future to survive in the present. But she needed about 10 days to do the paperwork to get that through. And the electric company repeated their intention to shut her off within 24 hours, after which she would have to pay more than $4,000 to get it back on. So after hours on the phone, we only won that case on the morning of the threatened shutoff by finally getting the state's Board of Public Utilities to follow through on a medical protection law that we found on the books, but which they have failed to enforce repeatedly. Then within a 2-day span, the same thing happened to another member, same amount, same situation. A third member this week is a senior citizen in her late 60s with associate's, bachelor's, and master's degrees. A lifetime of work leaves her with $1,200 monthly Social Security. It's a little less than average. She lost her apartment in March when her apartment building raised the rent by $100 a month. She had to start staying in the living rooms of friends and relatives, sleeping on an air mattress or a chair, living out of her car. All of this time, she was working, trying to raise enough money to afford an apartment. She applied for assistance, but on the basis that she, quote unquote, made too much, she was turned down for subsidized housing, Medicaid, and even food stamps. Then the big department store chain where she worked, this just happened a few days ago, assigned her what retailers call cloaking, which is closing at night and opening next morning, which requires the worker's presence until 11 p.m. and then back the next morning at 6 a.m. She is, as I said, in her late 60s, so she asked her supervisor for permission to get off at 10 p.m. and was granted it. But he didn't tell her that a computer would automatically assess her a penalty despite his permission. And that same week, she suffered a fall. She injured her foot. She submitted a doctor's note and called in each day as she recovered. When she returned to work, they terminated her, saying that the computer automatically assessed her a penalty point for every day that she missed. So I use these examples to evoke empathy rather than sympathy, a sense of identification rather than a feeling of guilt. Maybe even that slightly old-fashioned word, solidarity. More likely than not, you work for a living, or maybe you used to before age or disability brought earlier years of productivity to a close. And there's dignity in work, but not much money to be made from it in today's United States. A few facts will illustrate what I mean. In 2020, a little more than 54% of U.S. residents had an annual household income of less than $75,000. That's household income, so that's multiple people typically working in the house. 13 million U.S. households, that's more than 10% of the total, own zero financial assets in any form. In fact, they have negative net worth. That means that the amount of debt that they owe exceeds the value of anything that might be in their name. Another 20% of households have no assets besides their primary residence. No 401k, no IRA, no after-tax investment account. Nothing beyond the value of the primary residence. According to a recent Gallup poll, 18% of full-time employees in the U.S. work at least 60 hours per week. Meanwhile, just 14% of U.S. households directly own any stock. In other words, more people work the equivalent of 5 12-hour days than all the direct owners of stock put together. Meanwhile, 94% of net job growth between 2005 and 2015 was in the alternative work category. That means independent contractors, freelancers, contract company workers, not traditional 9-to-5 employment. I think it's fair to say that many of us simply haven't come to terms with this reality. If we're financially drive in ways like the examples I gave, we often think it's because there's something uniquely wrong with us individually, that we did something wrong. Now, on the other hand, if at the moment we're doing better financially, we tend to assume that conditions are more common than these statistics demonstrate and more stable than history has borne out. So Eastern Service Workers Association is an organizing drive of poorly paid workers, service workers in South Jersey. What are service workers? Well, 80% of the U.S. workforce, that's the first thing to know. Service workers do everything from hospitality to healthcare, from retail to food service, from education to security, from customer service to cosmetology to consulting. That's one reason we joke that our name, ESWA, can stand for every single worker around. These days, the jobs many of our members do, like home health aides, cleaners, they're often called essential workers. But they've never been, and they still are not, paid enough to afford essentials. That's the basic problem. So service workers in South Jersey need organization because alone, isolated, the best that any of us can hope for is that maybe we can get ahead as an individual, forgetting about what happens to everybody else. It's true that some people do make it, but we can't all make it. That's why ESWA, that's why we're building organizations. So we can unite the many different members of our community, each affected in their own way, around common interests, and fight for change, not just for some of us, but for all of us. Working people, and those out of work, or disabled, or too old to work, volunteer together to fight to change our own poverty conditions, along with anyone else who's concerned. Students, teachers, professionals, small business owners, clergy, a lot of other concerned residents. Day to day, members work together to build benefit programs like emergency food, legal advice, even free non-emergency dental care, some forms of preventive medical care. The Congress has been very supportive in all those efforts. It's not about charity, but about those facing the toughest conditions uniting for survival while demanding that the government act now to end poverty. Everything about our structure is premised on what it will take to actually end poverty. Not just nibble around its edges. Accordingly, ESWA is all volunteer with no paid staff at any level. We're grassroots, we accept no government funding. We're an unincorporated membership association. We have no geographic boundaries or eligibility criteria for our membership benefits. Our office at 53 East Washington Avenue in Pleasantville is open 7 days a week, 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. every day of the year, staffed by volunteers. We unite the lowest paid first, primarily through canvassing. John's going to talk more about that, going house to house, door to door, every week. It's unprecedented for the lowest paid workers to have a labor organization of our own. And in that sense, it's a labor organization of a new type. Using this method, we've been able to build grassroots leadership from the bottom up. Membership is open to anyone who sees the need for organization, is willing to do what they can to help the next member, and agrees to donate voluntary dues of 62 cents a month, 62 cents a month, if and when they can. If you can't afford it, doesn't matter. Still have all the same benefits as anyone. Members bring their concerns to a weekly membership meeting, which is called the Workers' Benefit Council, where we discuss work and wages and related conditions in our community and what we can do about it. We respond often with immediate relief to membership needs like food, clothing, holiday items, school supplies, those basic campaigns of the membership benefits program. And at other times, other kinds of campaigns deal with policies that take even more money out of our pockets. There are many examples I could give you, but in recent years, our members have accomplished a string of victories, so I'll try to sum those up. In 2017, our members were instrumental in the campaign to prevent the sale of the Atlantic City Municipal Water System to New Jersey American Water, which probably would have resulted in the rates going up by about 80% based on state averages. In 2018, our members played the deciding role in forcing the Board of Public Utilities to cut $89 million from a water rate hike here on the mainland and stop the precedent of enacting rate hikes without government pre-approval. In 2019, a delegation of our members prevented privatization of the Pleasantville sewer system, which again would likely raise the rate significantly. And in 2020, members and allies wanted temporary housing worth about $1,000 per tenant for a number of illegally evicted motel residents along the Black Rose Pike. And this brings us to why we're compelled to respond to government policies, to the role of the institutions of government, particularly at the state level or not, which have historically so often aided and abetted increased poverty conditions that we face in our community. Martin Luther King has a great quote. He said, "True compassion is more than flinging a coin to a beggar. It comes to see that an edifice which produces beggars needs restructuring." The Board of Public Utilities in New Jersey, I'll give that as an example. That's five officials appointed by the governor. They approve rate increases that our members struggle to save and struggle and scrimp and save in an effort to pay. In fact, the Board of Public Utilities actually guarantees as policy that the electric company will have an annual profit of 10%. With those substantial earnings, the parent company of the electric utility paid nearly $500 million in dividends last year to its five largest institutional shareholders. Those are Wall Street firms like Vanguard and BlackRock and State Street. And this is not money that goes back into Joe and Jane Sixpack's retirement account. A lot of us think that. But the reality is, statistically, nearly 90% of Americans own none of those stocks. And this is not a secret. These profits are enabled by what the electric company's parent company, in their quarterly earnings report to investors, called, quote, constructive regulatory relationships. In other words, they were talking about how they could get the government to approve those rate increases. By such means, by such alarming and thorough control of our institutions of government, profits have now increased 37% in a single year last year, reaching $3 trillion. That's the largest increase since the government started tracking that number 74 years ago. And every quarter last year, the average U.S. corporate profit margin was above 13%, a level reached only once for a few months in the past 70 years. So the stories I was telling at the beginning have a direct relationship to that situation. Another leader from our membership spent decades as a single mother, working two or three jobs, often 16 hours a day in a casino as a skills coach for the developmentally disabled. After decades, she paid off her home. She was tremendously proud. She owned it free and clear. Then the property taxes started rising in the community where she lived. And she was desperate not to fall behind on the taxes. She wouldn't lose the home after she put so much work into it. So she skimped on her electric bill to pay off her property taxes. She took that money out of what she budgeted to pay. And then the company notified her that they would be coming to shut her off. So I called the company together with her in our office to try to save that shuttle. It was 2 days before the onset of a seasonal moratorium, the only kind of actual dependable moratorium on shutoffs that there is in the state of New Jersey. And she was wheezing into the phone as her breathing machine required her to do. And they refused to give any guarantee that the shutoff truck wouldn't pull up at any minute. After that experience, this is what she said as part of a delegation of members and their allies that spoke before a hearing of that same Board of Public Utilities that I just mentioned. She said, "No justice, no peace. Until we have justice, you will have no peace." And that was not a threat, it was just a statement of fact. A few years ago, the director of the Division of Customer Service at the New Jersey Board of Public Utilities told me that utility customers in New Jersey are in a no-win situation. Because I was addressing them to another situation like this. They said the rates have gone up. This household income is stuck right there. They're already working as much as they can. How are they going to pay more? What are they going to do to forestall this shutoff? And he said they're in a no situation, except he didn't exactly say that. What he did say was in language that I can't use in a sanctuary. He was able to admit that, in a moment of honesty, because he was weeks away from retirement. So he let us in on the reality of the situation that his institution was part of helping to further these endless rate increases and income stuck where they are. but he didn't offer any solutions. And our members, our community, we need a solution. Because those are just examples. More and more of us have this growing gap between income and expenses. And lives do really hang in the balance. Now, the reason ESWA members formed a utility advocacy benefit was because their health and safety was endangered by shutoffs, and they lacked the money to forestall them. The reason ESWA members formed an emergency food benefit is because they were hungry and needed food. In short, the driving force in the labor movement historically is that workers unite to end their suffering, because they're the ones enduring the suffering, and they find that it takes organization, strength in numbers, to stop it. Now, you can look at any major world religion, Christianity, Judaism, Islam, Buddhism, as well as agnostic and atheistic humanist traditions. And all of them have a moral code central to them. All of them say feeding the hungry, healing the sick, etc. is the right thing to do. More overtly and articulately than perhaps any other community of believers, Unitarian Universalist traditions and principles reflect that commonality of belief. The first principle, the inherent worth and dignity of every person. The second principle, justice, equity, and compassion in human relations. These are among the seven principles of Unitarian Universalism, in part because they're the core beliefs of so many faith traditions. Now, the title of this talk is You Can Make a Difference. And the first step towards doing that is to realize that you are part of a we. After all, what do doctors and lawyers and stockbrokers and government workers and trade union members and small business owners have in common with farm and domestic and seasonal and service workers? All are part of an economy that relies on all of them. All are mutually dependent as purchasers and sellers of goods and services who find their lives and livelihoods potentially disrupted when money is removed from the pockets of other working people. And all own the ability to work together to improve conditions in our community. The lesson is that there's strength in organization, and literally everyone can play an active role in making change by joining with those of us who have the least in building organization that will help all of us ensure that our needs are being met. So John is going to fill you in on some of the specifics, and then we'll wrap up.
Hello.
Good morning.
Hey. Good job. So, first, you can choose organizing as a profession. Volunteers are urgently needed to do the hard work of uniting all the strata of our working communities to meet the challenges placed upon us during these urgent times. I coordinate organizer training programs and can talk to anybody who's interested about how to participate. Number two, you can join us on our Member Week membership canvases. Every Saturday, teams of ESWA volunteers and members go door to door to reach the lowest paid workers in our neighborhoods here in South Jersey, workers who need organization and who need ESWA's benefits program. Some, like Andy described, are choosing between heat and food. This is how we build a fight for change from the bottom up. That's how we build for on the job training, so you can learn to make a difference right off the bat as you go. Number three, anyone can be of assistance, regardless of your age, physical condition, education level, social skills, confidence, whatever. Twice a week, we do advocacy to assist our members in keeping their gas, electric, or utility, bills on, much more. This is all much more than just a handful of us can tackle. We have to reach and we have to involve a lot more people to accomplish these things. We're going to need more volunteers, more drivers, more support, more phoners, typists, letter writers, food, clothing sorters, you name it. We need your help. Fourth, you may have a professional skill you could share in construction, in the culinary arts, in writing, in computers, in healthcare, in the law, you name it. It can positively impact the lives of these members all across the area. And finally, we invite you to join with members of membership of low-income workers by participating in this year's annual back-to-school campaign. We're collecting backpacks, school supplies, and new or like new uniforms. You can do collections in your neighborhood, in your workplace, your school, and your place of worship. The goal is to make this a fall of hope and excitement for the children of enrolled members. Items can be dropped off at our office between 53 East Washington Avenue in Pleasantville, anytime between 9 a.m. and 9 p.m., 7 days a week. Volunteers are urgently needed to play a role in this campaign, sorting these supplies, preparing them for the recipient families, and assisting with the distribution itself. For more information about any of these opportunities to make a difference, please enter the tables, maybe one behind you, in the hallway too, after the service, or you can call us at our office at 609-646-9814. You can answer me, I'm John, 609-646-9814. That's basically what I got here.
So it's great. I also want to extend a really welcoming invitation to everyone. Our 45th anniversary celebration is coming up this coming Saturday, 23rd of July. It's in a donated space in a church in Pleasantville on Route 9 New Road, where it crosses the Black Horse Pike. It's a really great opportunity to kind of physically bring together so many of the folks, including all the congregation members here that have been so instrumental in so much that's been accomplished, and to kind of feel the sense of ownership that you deserve. And I often say that there's certain congregations that, at least in our awareness, are kind of punching above their weight, and these are definitely one of those. So if you can join us, it's from 4 to 7 next Saturday, the 23rd of July, and everyone is welcome. We will have folks being vaccinated and wearing a mask, so it's safe in that regard. And again, we're going to be at the tables in the back, so I look forward to an opportunity to meet and speak with anyone who can stop by. Thanks so much.
Everyone would rise in mind, body, and spirit. Some of them are all of them. We're going to come sing a song with me, number 346. Then we're going to do verses 1, 2, and 3 only.
Yeah.
who were shy in the congregation. I'm not shy, but one of the things I do sometimes when I don't have a lot of spare time to be in Pleasantville to volunteer, I look at the local Facebook groups and I reach out to people and say, hey, do you guys have some school supplies or maybe some juice packets you can donate to this cause? There's something for everyone. John and Andy were saying to get involved. And I won't be there. My son's getting married next Saturday.
Yay!
I'll be there for the back to school stuff. Let's read the words together for extinguishing the chalice.
Extinguish the flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
Thank you so much. This week. This summer, the children and youth in our children's RE program are exploring service to others. Our first principal asks us to treat each person with dignity and respect. We're going to make Ziploc bags of things people who are unhoused might need, such as a toothbrush, deodorant, and even a snack to keep them going. But we need help collecting all the items. Donations can be brought in to UUCSJS through August 21st. See Jess Dunn-Sarnoff for more information. We are in need of flowers for the chalice table. Please speak with Colby right here. If you wish to bring an arrangement for your choosing to our chalice table for a Sunday service. Eastern Service Workers Association is in need of a working electric typewriter. If you have one down in the rear of your closet or up in the attic that can be donated to ESWA, please let Colby Tippins know. Talk has been brewing again about coffee hour, but we need a steady rotation of volunteers to make this work. Again, perfect job for the shy people. We're looking for those that can come in early, around 9 o'clock to 9:15 on Sunday, to get things ready and for folks to help with cleanup afterwards, those of us who are late to the congregation. Richard, our minister of coffee, will be meeting today after service with anyone interested in volunteering. So this is you with the red shirt, right here. This Richard, yeah. Join us next Sunday when Grace Note Singers, this sounds really exciting. They'll share their song repertoire and invite us to sing along. The group will explain what they do as a part of the Grace Healthcare System's hospice program. The service will also include meditative readings and some silent time together. The Grace Note Singers include our own Barbara Miller, Cynthia Chubinsky, Melissa Hutchinson, and as well as other local singers. And you help people as they are transitioning, yes, to the next life. How would this one? We warmly welcome all of you who are visiting today. Parents are encouraged to stay for the final moments of worship and to retrieve their children from outside or downstairs, wherever they are, after the bell has sounded. I think I see the kids. Now let us share a moment of silent reflection to consider today's message and the meaning it has in our lives.